Welcome to our tribute of Roger's achievements today. Firstly, I'm Dina. For those of you who may not have met me before, or may not have met me for some of the earlier years, I'm unique, got a face and a name, which is I. It's very sad that we come together today, only after Roger's passed away, to recognise what he achieved during his career and his influence in aviation preservation. However, in putting this celebration together over the last few weeks, it's been a privilege to have had contact with everyone here and with others who could not be with us, but who are thinking of us here today. It's been reassuring and rewarding to reflect that each of us has a story and a unique connection with Roger. Two vital people in the organisation of this event have been Julian Temple from Brooklands and Tom Singfield from the Friends of Viscount Stephen Pearcy. Julian, I can see here. Tom, where are you? Wait. Well, Tom is over there. Thank you very much, Jim. They stepped forward immediately to generously offer this prestigious and wholly appropriate venue, and without them both, today could not have been happening. May I also introduce Sally and Angel, who are seated over there. Would you like to wave? For those who don't know them, Roger's wife and daughter, and since adopting their new home in the UK, they've wholeheartedly embraced the Britannia Aircraft Preservation Trust, spending many hours at Speak on Charlie Fox with Roger. And on their behalf today, I'd like to thank you for your presence, the many kind words, the gestures of condolences, and the donations to the restoration in Roger's memory. I'd like to now hand you over to Julian Temple from Brooklyn.
Roger's best known, of course, for his efforts in preserving Bristol Britannia Charlie Fox, as you'll hear more about shortly, over the last three decades, of course. And few people perhaps realise now that he also assisted our museum considerably over a similar period of time. I just want to explain this a little more. He was, in fact, instrumental in the creation of our nationally important collection of Brooklands built airliners, most of which you can see in this photo here, recent shot about 2 months ago. And this was particularly in the formative years of the museum, the late 80s, early 90s. He personally went out of his way to help us acquire our BC-10, Viscount India Mike, and our Viking. And additionally, Roger and his talented engineer, the late, much lamented Nick Bates, enabled us to also acquire our XRAF Vickers Varsity and our B206 and Beagle Pup prototypes in the early 90s. So the story begins with me and Roger really in spring 1987, nearly 30 years ago now. A mutual friend, Peter Amos, who is here today. I knew Peter from working on a History of Mars aircraft book project a couple of years earlier before I came to Brooklands. He knew Roger, and they happened to hear that Sultan of Oman was about to retire this aircraft, which was then the world's last civilian operated example of the type. And in fact, we heard it was going to be possibly blown up as an anti-terrorist training exercise in the desert. The British crew, who Roger I think already knew some of them by chance, they were dismayed to hear that. And at that point, this museum was barely off the ground. It was got the Wellington bomber from Loch Ness. And we weren't really looking at anything post-World War II in terms of preserving it. And this was a kind of game changer in a way. And Roger happened to know Dennis Lowry, who was the boss of the Omani Royal Flight, went out at his expense to see the guy and managed to then get the Sultan of Oman indirectly, but therefore sanctioned it being donated to the Brooklands Museum. And it was flown into Brooklands on the Viking throat on 6th of July 1987. Here's the landing shot coming in from the south end over Byfleet. So that was the first aircraft Roger helped us get. There were, I think, six altogether. And it was actually just before the Varsity came on the scene. As some of you may know, Roger had acquired the ownership of the Britannia in 1985, Charlie Fox at Manston. But then quite biggest plans were to do with it until we came along and we said, oh, could we temporarily part the fuselage here in two sections, which Nick Bates had just separated. So of course we said, yeah, a couple of months would be fine. I think it was 4 years later it finally left the Danwell. But we were grateful to Roger and he was grateful to us, obviously. But then in the meantime, our post-war shopping list had a Varsity on it. This is the 14th or the 18th aircraft built, and this was under threat at Simpson Airfield near Peterborough, where it had last flown in the 70s. And we got a team together, we got a grant, I think, from the Museums and Galleries Commission, and we were able to actually employ Roger's engineer, Nick, through Crouch's Aero Services, to take the aircraft apart, and it was then transported back to Brooklands and put together over a period of time. And in fact, Andy Lambert, who obviously got to know us by this time, got involved then. And yeah, that aircraft is now looking really splendid. There's two members of the team here in the audience today, so by all means, do go and have a look at that. That was quite a challenging boat job, but I think with the winter conditions, I think it even snowed the day we went to collect the aircraft fuselage. So that came here in November 88, and it was took about 18 months to, no, 17th of July 89 it was assembled, exactly in time for the 40th anniversary of the prototype. Then, of course, another challenge was Bike Out Stephen Pearcy. So, Tom Singfield will say a bit more about this in a moment, but I've put a couple of pictures in. You know, we really had a Bike Out on our shopping list. They were still flying at Southend with George Burton and people at British World, the British Air Ferries. And we particularly had our eye on one that was dedicated to the memory of the late Stephen Pearcy. And that aircraft had an unfortunate ground accident. No one was hurt, but Could we preserve it? And back then, that was the next project. Roger really got stuck into that one. I think single-handedly almost he steered the project for several times when we didn't have the money and couldn't get things working in time. But we persevered, and I'll leave Tom to tell more of the story of that. But that arrived 11th of February 1990. The fuselage came through the Dartford Tunnel. I think it's one of the first aircraft that he brought through the Dartford Tunnel, I'm sure Andy mentioned. And We had a big sort of photo call the very next morning before we offloaded. We got people like Sir George Edwards and Jock Bryce and Sir Bean Mason who all came to pose with Roger and others who'd been involved. So a memorable day then. And that's a fairly recent picture of the aircraft as it is now, but in fact it even looks better than that today. So do go and have a look at the bike camp afterwards. This was a bit of a one-off and surprise. It wasn't on our shopping list. That was two aircraft there. This is the Beagle 206, or Beagle Bassett almost, and Beagle Pup prototype. Neither are here today, but that was a surprise thanks to, I think, Sir Peter Masefield, Lobby and Roger, without any reference to my boss, Moran, at the time, or myself. And I think almost the first thing we knew was when the trucks came through the gate and he said, where do you want them, mate? we did keep them for quite a while, in fact, although they arrived in November 1990 from Shoreham, where they'd been subject to, I think, an aborted plan for a museum there that never got off the ground, so they were pretty much under threat. A lot of salt water corrosion in the air, at the Beagle 206. But they came here, we managed to get the ownership clarified, and in fact they were then donated to the museum, and we then actually sold the Pup prototype to a private owner who was going to get it back airworthy, and is still trying to get it airworthy. There's a lot of problems with paperwork being a while, but that may still apply at some point. And we used the money then to buy actually another aircraft for our collection that we were looking to secure, I think it went towards the Blair Group purchase. And we did offer it to other museums, no one else was interested, so we were then able to sell it. So, and the 206 is now on display at the Farnborough Aviation Museum, just down the road. If anyone hasn't seen it there, do look it up. This is where Roger actually got, he stuck with Beagle, of course. There's a Bristol connection, as I'm sure the Bristol guys will know. It was a design office project when Sir Peter Masefield was the boss of Bristol Aeroplane Company, and he was chairman of our trustees, of course, when he got the aircraft here in whatever it was now, 1990. So, and Roger, of course, with being a trustee of Bristol Aero Collection by the early 90s, their store at Kendall had the Beagle 206, and a little bit of work was done on it there before ultimately we managed to get it back to Shoreham in time for a Beagle aircraft reunion in 2005. And last but not least, the Vickers Viking. I don't have most of my pictures, are not digital amount of that project, but that was on the M6 somewhere near Birmingham, I think, with National Rescue moving the Viking fuselage, where the RF Museum at Cosford had it on loan from British Airways for a long period of time. They couldn't keep it in a building, in a hangar, which British Airways worked with the assistant on. And it was Roger, I think, by knowing the right people at British Airways and the RF Museum at Cosford, effectively broken a deal for us and said, you can have it on loan at Brooklands. Eventually, British Airways did donate it to us a few years ago as well. So that was a major project to we had to put it in the hangar without its wings on. And further renovation, there's Dave Gilmore and I'm not sure John Silver's here, but there are other members of the team still actively working on this aircraft as a long-term project today. It's got no interior, of course, it ended up as a roadside cafe in Holland before the RF Museum built it, and that's now in our aircraft park. And that really was the last project Roger got involved with. He didn't get involved in the Vanguard. We didn't really need him, I guess, in that sense. And he was obviously busy with the Britannia and other things. And the Vimy, another almost prop line, you could say, he didn't get involved in that. But he was very supportive all the time, kept in touch. I'd see him regularly at BAPC meetings. And he would come up for a chat and a pint sometimes and just have a generally keeping in touch. And we had, of course, anniversaries here. This is actually at Ray and Patsy Pierce's home in West Byfleet, 2008. I don't know, do we mention Patsy's here today at the front of the room? So we're delighted that Patsy could make it today. Good to see you. And there's, of course, Roger just reminiscing with, I think that's Mike Sessions, just over his shoulder. Colin Tell, the Viscount pilot, who took us on a number of fundraising flights. Andy Lander, of course, to the left, and Max New from the Viscount team to the right. But, and really just look at the aircraft park again from the other angle. You've got in the foreground, bottom of the picture, the Varsity, then the Viking, further forward of that, and the Viscount just in front of that. And then, of course, the Sultan's VC-10 dominating the aircraft park beyond that. So all those aircraft will be open today. Do go and have a look at them. I'll just end by saying, from my point of view, Roger's long-standing commitment to Brooklands Museum and his personal contribution in helping us to preserve six significant historic aircraft is unique and hugely appreciated. But on that note, I'd like to hand over now to our next speaker, who is, I think, is it Tom?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
My name's Tom Sinkfield. You've probably heard it mentioned a few times in passing by previous speakers. I'm a retired air traffic controller. I'm currently a volunteer at Brooklands, where I help out with the Viscount, Stephen Piercy, and I'm also in charge, supposedly, of the Friends of Viscount Stephen Piercy, which is the name of the Viscount here. Amongst other things, I now do. I'm still a mad enthusiast to take pictures. I write books and travel the world. Anyway, that's me. I met Roger, as far as I can recall, back in the late 70s, so it's probably a very long time ago. I found a picture that I took of him and Dina at the Duxford Air Show, 1979, when Roger had massive, long, dark hair. Yes, we all got grey in here. And I first met him, I think it was probably through a combination of Peter Amos and through Stephen Piercy, because we all sort of knew each other from that time. Stephen was a good chum of mine. And as Julian said, the fact that the Viscount is here is pretty much, a lot of it's down to what Roger did. So anyway, Roger was already involved in the late 80s with Brooklands Museum, as we've heard about, because of the VC-10, which was all down to him. You also saw that awful crash on the ground at South End with the Viscount, which was in January 1988, where the whole front of the plane was virtually destroyed. A few months later in April, Roger, as we said, moved his Britannia Charlie Fox fuselage parts into Brooklands, where it remained for some time. So he was knew all about the museum, and he knew also about the shopping list for what was required. So he then, well, along with Julian, put two and two together. And when this Viscount eventually got, it was being used at Southend as a spare parts tree, virtually. You know, all the bits were coming off of it. It was being stripped down. So it wasn't in a very nice state. But eventually, British World Airlines, or BAF as it previously was, decided to dispose of it. And in June 89, they phoned Roger and said, you know, this is available. Do you think anybody would like it? So obviously, Brooklands was right up there, number one. We heard earlier on that the National Rescue guys, Andy Lambert and his team, they were responsible for moving the parts around, and Mick Bates was there with his spanners and screwdrivers, gallantly tearing it to pieces, ready for reconstruction back here. It's a shame that Mick's not around to see the end result of his work, because, well, again, like Roger, the Viscount would not be in any state without that man's skills. So, Indian Mike, the Viscount, then moved in here in February 1990. it was going to cost a lot of money to get it back on its feet and looking good. So Roger started to raise funds as a separate little like side affair. Initially he got the Science Museum involved, and he had a fund set up courtesy of them whereby any money donated would go towards the bike out. Later on there was a small group of friends, mostly friends of the, you know, Steve Piercy. We formed what became called the Friends of Bike Out Steve Piercy. The idea being was that we would organise events and whatever we could do, print postcards, whatever, to fundraise. And over the years, that's we've raised thousands and thousands. It's been really impressive what we've actually managed to get. The first fundraiser was organised by Roger and Andy Lambert in conjunction with Mike Sessions and Steve's parents, Patsy and Ray Piercy. And this was quite a historic day because it was the 40th anniversary of the world's first scheduled turbine airline service, which flew from Norfolk to Paris. And we did a reconstruction flight out of Norfolk in one of the Baff Viscounts to Paris to Bourget in July 1990. And it was a glorious day, and we had a lovely time over there. It was a little bit of fun, but I don't think we actually made any money out of that one, but it was a very good treat. The funds in 1993 helped to pay for Viscount to be repainted. It was parked over there, and the team came around and did it all outside. We covered everything over and sprayed it all up in the British, was it British Royal Airlines colours in those days, with the red, still in red, white and blue. So the friends paid for that. We also did flights. We organised various flights in Viscounts because obviously they were still in service with Bath. We flew to Duxford, we flew to Jersey, we flew to Bale. And in 1996, when the Viscount was being retired from service, we went full out then. That was when we organised a huge number of farewell Viscount flights, which took place down at Lydd. Roger was a good friend and a wonderful facilitator in the aviation preservation scene, and he'd be greatly missed, but we're all hoping that the Britannia Charlie Fox will become a lasting memorial to him and his passion. I'd personally like to thank Julian and the Trust for allowing this event to take place here, Dina for her organising skills, Andy for his video stuff, and let's hope we can get a fly pass today, so thank you very much.
Well, yes, I'm Eric Turret. I'm one of the trustees of the Britannia Trust, and also I run the Eagle Group of Companies archives. I have this tendency to wander around. It was after a meeting with Roger, quite a long time ago now, and I began to realise that we had a number of things in common. A love of aviation. I used to work for British Eagle, I worked for overseas aviation prior to that, and there was this natural love of aviation, of aeroplanes. There was a love of steam railways. Why steam railways? Well, Roger was a member of the Bluebell Railway. I've been a member of the Bluebell Railway for many, many years, and drive steam engines now. We were both employed by British Eagle. Albeit, Roger was with Eagle for only 5 days. Eagle, of course, went out of business 5 days after he had started. But he was on the payroll. He didn't get anything because there was no money there. But he was on the payroll. And also, both of us, Roger Hale and I, hold a master's degree in a very, very special subject, the art of hoarding things. Although I have to admit that he had a far higher grade mark than I did. He had a 40-foot container to start with. He had a roof, an attic, totally chock-a-block with things very much Britannia related. So we had quite a few things in common. The purpose of our first meeting was for me actually to be reacquainted with an aircraft that I had worked on way back in the 60s, Roger's beloved Charlie Fox. I remember the day when Charlie Fox arrived at Heathrow in transcontinental SA colours. He stood over on the north side in the fog, and eventually, after customs agreed, it was pulled over to our base at Heathrow. Very quickly, it was put into the hangar and checked for, thus the freight door, the very first freight door on a civilian aircraft to be done. BOECC wasn't practical, wasn't viable, it was going to cost too much money. But Eagle was an expert at putting freight doors in aeroplanes. Well, we kept in contact, and then one day he phoned me and said, got some bad news. So I said, oh, what's the problem? So he said that the life of Charlie Fox was very much in the balance. It was to be taken out of the hangar at Kemble, and he was looking for a place for it to go to, but wasn't having much luck. I think he had, if I remember certainly right, had about 3 months to sort it out. And eventually, as again, most of you will know, it sat outside the hangar on the grass for quite a long time. Try as he might, no one seemed to want it, this great and wonderful beast. But eventually, a group known as the Jetstream Club made contact and negotiated with the then hotel manager at Liverpool, a speak, the old terminal building, that it could go there. And sure enough, that's where it's come. And that's where it's going to stay. Because to be quite honest, because of all the new buildings around the area, it's going to go nowhere. Roger gave many, many years of total commitment to restoration. We've already been told of the aeroplanes here at Brooklands. And then, of course, there is Victor Tango at Duxford. I remember Victor Tango when he first arrived at Eagle. And a cart pulled up and it was full of beer for everyone to celebrate our first 312. Victor Fox at Cosford. Shall I tell you something about Victor Fox? It took me 15 years to get permission to go on board Victor Fox to take photographs of the cockpit. It only happened this year that they would allow me to get onto the flight deck. Radiation was the problem for the instruments. And I said, well, you know, I used to sit in that seat working on the instrument panels. Our crews used to fly for hours in front of them, and they're way up in their 80s and 90s now. No, you can't go. Well, very kindly, actually, as help from Alistair, yeah, one of our volunteers at the speak, is involved to Cosford, negotiated with a new manager to be able to take photographs. And of course, the Britannia at Kemble. Roger was a likeable guy, always ready to encourage people he met, and particularly the volunteers working on Charlie Fox. We'll never really ever know just how much hard-earned cash Roger put into this project of restoring Charlie Fox. His commitment was amazing. Roger had a very good mate in Nick Bates. It was he, as you know, who took the aeroplane to pieces. When Mick passed away, Roger was devastated. He phoned me and, although I couldn't see him, I sensed the tears rolling down his eyes. He was very, very sad of Mick going. I suppose you could could sum up Roger by saying that he was committed, he was determined, and he was persistent. And from what I've learned over the years, he was very much a professional in his career. He had a wide knowledge of his job. At the same time, though, Roger never suffered from his gravity. Over the years, and even today, some imply that following Roger's dream, it was an impossible dream to restore Charlie Fox. And yes, it has gone on for a long time, but in preservation world, that's how it is. And there have been difficulties, and sometimes they've come up one after the other. But yet, his determination to carry through, and to carry through his vision that he had of seeing Charlie Fox up on his legs, and painted, of course, in British Eagle colours. We all miss Roger very much. But today we have with us Sally, an angel. And they miss him so much more than we do. And I want, on behalf of everyone, Sally and Angel, to offer to you our sympathy, our support, and our love at this time. And always feel free to contact us.
My name's Andy Lambert, and like many of you, I was a friend of Roger Hargreaves. In the 80s, my company, National Rescue, was based in the control tower on the Brooklands site. As a result, we did the odd job for the museum and were asked to help Roger's company, Proteus Aero Services, rescue a Varsity aircraft from Simpson Aerodrome in Cambridgeshire. At the same time, we also met his top engineer, Mike Bates. After Mike had prepared the aircraft, we loaded it to take it to Brooklands. Next day, we offloaded the Varsity at Brooklands. This was the first of many aviation recovery photo calls. The next little Roger job is a well-known Viscount called Stephen. It's funny, you know, how Roger's jobs were always in the winter. An oops moment coming up, but also look out for Roger's self-preservation instinct kicking in. Several hours later, we are on way to Brooklands. Then there was the two Beagle prototypes. Roger asked us to move from Shoreham to Brooklands as a surprise present for the museum. This is the Bloodhound missile we moved from RAF West Raynham to Quedgeley in 1991. It was here where we first met Charlie Fox's wing. Then, of course, there was the Herald. Here we are refitting the Herald's wings at Woodley. Here we're unloading the Viking we had just recovered from Cosford to Brooklands. Then, of course, there was Charlie. Here we are moving it to Brooklands, November 1992.
Let's get that from Brolin.
Just a few years later, we were craning Charlie Fox again. Here we're loading it for it to go to Banwell. Yet another winter job in Starmitt's Britannia RX, going from Boscombe down to Banwell. Next there was Charlie Fox's wings from Quedgeley to Kemble.
Hargreaves working this, I've got to get.
I threw it on his toe.
Lastly, we should also remember those wonderful trips and other events raising funds for Viscount Stephen Pearcy.
With Britannia's for what, 35 years? Long time.
Yeah, since about 1968.
1968, yeah. Yes. When it used to ferry things like Brooklands and things to Europe, Australia. And so Roger has a long love affair with the Britannia. Because of the various charities and funding bodies we are applying to for help with the ALRX with the facility, they require you to actually own as much of the collection as you possibly can. And it will, at the moment, this is on loan to us. And having explained that to Roger, he's very kindly offered to donate RX to the ALRX collection. That's from today.
It's going to be today.